Hello everyone and welcome to We Meet at Digital Days. My name is Marie-Therese Kohl and I will moderate this presentation. We are very pleased that you took the time to participate in our virtual conference. The topic of this presentation is Wirepath Mesh from Concept to Prototyping. And our speakers are Matthias Hauser and Lukas Setembre. They will hold the presentation and will answer your questions. But before we start, I would like to point out one thing. You will be muted during the presentation. This means that you cannot ask questions during the presentation. Nevertheless, you have the opportunity to ask questions during the presentation at any time via the chat function. You will find the chat function in the control panel. The presentation will be about 30 minutes long. The chat questions will be answered in a Q&A session following the webinar. There are about 5 to 10 minutes in addition scheduled for this. If we are unable to answer all your questions within this time, we will answer them via email afterwards. And if you still have any other questions left, just mail us at exhibition@we-online.com and we will try to answer all of your questions promptly. At the end of the webinar, you will be asked to participate in a feedback survey. We would be pleased if you take the time to fill out a survey and help us to improve the event. You will receive the link to the presentation in the next few days, and the recording will be available at our website shortly. But now I will hand over to the first speaker, and I wish you an exciting presentation.
Thank you, Marie. I'm very happy for the opportunity to talk today. Our today's topic is Wirepath Mesh from concept to prototyping. Let's start with today's agenda. We will start with some basics about the mesh networks. We'll see the main distinctions we can make within the mesh networks. We will then introduce Wirepath, starting with the company and then going deeper into the characteristics of Wirepath Mesh firmware. At this point of the presentation, I will hand over to my colleague, Matthias Hauser, that will then complete the session with talking about the Wirepath stack structure and giving a live demonstration with our Thetis One module and evaluation kit, and he will show you how to set up a prototype network in few steps. What is a mesh network? A mesh network is a network of connected nodes where messages are propagated through the net to the dedicated receiver. We can identify some main parameters of mesh networks that are particularly interesting from user's perspective. These are speed, current consumption, throughput, maximum number of nodes, and then, of course, how easy or difficult it is to install these nodes and maintain these nodes in the network, and how much, exactly how much maintenance the overall network requires, and then robustness of the network. A first important distinction we need to make within mesh networks is between flooding mesh networks and routing mesh networks. In flooding mesh, each node just forwards the incoming message on all outgoing links except the one it arrived on. That means if we have a source S and a destination D, the source, and we want to deliver the message from S to D, the node S will propagate the message on all its connections to the neighbor nodes that are, in this case, these two nodes, and so will proceed the propagation through the network until this message reaches the destination D. In routing mesh, we have a specific path that is chosen for the message from S to D. And again, here it's highlighted in red. So a specific path will be chosen for the message. We have, of course, in this network pros and cons, and we will discuss some of them in this slide. So starting with the flooding mesh, we have a relatively simple organization because every node just forwards the message to all its neighbors. But on the other end, this leads to the fact that we are delivering the message to nodes that are not destination nodes because the message is just propagated through the network. That can lead to increased traffic and duty cycle problems. On the routing mesh, we don't have we don't propagate so the message overall through the whole network, but because only a shortest or cheapest path is chosen. But on the other side, we need some organization that is the network master that will, let's say, define the paths for these messages. And in case the network is the size of the network is high, this can lead to problems. Also, these networks are in general less robust to network changes, again, because the master has to be, let's say, aware or informed about these changes. A second important distinction is between synchronous and asynchronous mesh. In synchronous mesh, the nodes can transmit and receive messages only in determined time slots, and in the rest of the time, they are in sleep mode. In asynchronous mesh, nodes can transmit and receive messages at any time. Again, here we have pros and cons coming from these two different solutions, and we want to discuss some of them. In synchronous mesh, we have a very energy efficient solution because, as said, the nodes are in a sleep mode for, let's say, most of the time, and so the energy consumption will be in general very low. But on the other side, this leads to the fact that we have a low throughput and higher latency within the network, because since the nodes can only transmit in these determined time slots, the delivery time, let's say, for the messages from source to destination will be higher because every node just transmits in these slots. In asynchronous mesh, receivers are always on and are able to transmit and receive. That means we have a higher throughput and lower latencies because receivers are always on, can transmit and receive without waiting for the time slot. But as cons in this solution, we have a higher in energy consumption and higher probability of radio packet collision. Let's introduce now Wirepass and see how, and we will see in the next couple of slides, how Wirepass firmware behaves with respect to this network characteristics that we have discussed. So Wirepass is an international company based in Finland, is specialized in IT ecosystems and offers a firmware called Wirepass Mesh. It's a software company. That means it cooperates with technology partners to integrate this firmware into radio devices and to develop Wirepass Mesh radio models. We as Wirtelectronic are licensed to develop, support, and sell standard and custom Wirepass Mesh radio models. In this slide, I would like to present the main concept of the Wirepass Mesh firmware, and we will go deeper into that in the next couple of slides. So first of all, let's talk about the overall structure. We have a network of interconnected nodes, so a mesh network, that basically the structure is that these nodes are connected to a sink or more sinks of the network that are the interface between these interconnected nodes and the IoT cloud. So, and in typical applications, all messages are delivered from the nodes to the sink. So this is the overall, let's say, the concept, and we work in the 2.4 gigahertz band. We can have two main solutions with a wire pass that are described on the left and on the right of this slide. We have an host-based operation where host microcontroller communicates with the wire pass device, integrating the wire pass mesh firmware and the hardware itself. We can have a standalone operation that means that wire pass mesh firmware, device hardware, and application itself are integrated in one item, let's say. In this text, we summarize the main characteristics of the wire pass mesh firmware. The main concept is that wire pass aims at overcoming the problems of large networks, where, let's say, when mesh networks go to large scale, decentralizing the network's infrastructure to the nodes themselves. So all the intelligence of the network is decentralized on the nodes. That means all networking decisions are done locally by the nodes. So we want to remove that infrastructure that we have seen or can become like the main problem when implementing routing mesh networks. So every node can take these decisions that are described in these green boxes. So every node scans automatically the network and chooses the best path to the sink, can adapt the transmit power to how far or how close is the next node, can act in different roles that we'll discuss later, can work in low power and low latency mode, and can choose the best frequency to use locally. So from this node's intelligence come the main advantages of the wire pass mesh firmware, that are the high configurability, the tolerance, so the interference tolerance, and the ultra low energy consumption. So we can already see what are the, let's say, best application scenarios for wire pass mesh. And basically, wherever we want to implement a routing mesh that is large scale and this has very strict requirements on energy consumption. Let's now go deeper into this firmware characteristics. We have discussed about the tree structure that is typically implemented in wire pass with gateway, sink, and then interface to the cloud, a sink where all messages from the mesh network are delivered. Different roles for the nodes are sink, non-router, and router. So the sink is again where all messages are delivered from the nodes, collect the data and forward it via gateway to IoT server. Non-router nodes can only send their own messages without being able to relay incoming radio packets, so from other nodes. This, of course, has an advantage in terms of energy consumption because they send less data. That means they also consume less energy in general. Router nodes can send own messages, but also relay incoming radio frames that are directed to other nodes or to the sink. Each node knows its neighbors and which neighbor node is the optimal node on the path to the dedicated sink. So this is, again, it's one of the most exciting things about wire pass. We have these two nodes, for example, here in the picture A and B. They will be able to recognize which is the next node to the sink. So in case of A, the message will be directly propagated to S, so to the sink. And in case of B, the neighbors are A, C, and D. Next node to the sink will be A. And so in this case, the message will reach the sink through A, so with two hops, let's say. Each link between two nodes has its own radio channel cost, transmission interval, and transmission power. That means for each link, this set of parameters is defined, and again can be different for every for every link. And the nodes are able to detect the cheapest path to deliver the message. This cost of the links can also be defined by the user so that some particular paths are preferred rather than others. So we have this, we can configure the network so that the traffic is, let's say, decentralized or is focused on some specific parts of the network based on this cost of each path. In this slide, we want to discuss some further features of the Wirepass Mesh firmware, and in particular, automatic network setup and self-healing. We can see that in this picture on the right of the slide. That means if a new node is available, for example, this new sync, the network will automatically adjust so that messages are propagated also to this sync wherever it makes sense. So these two nodes in this case will change their connection and propagate the messages directly to the new sync. In the same way, if a node is taken out of the network, if possible, the network will readjust to establish new connections to replace this node. So if this node now is taken out, for example, here we can, the network will adjust automatically so that this path is established from this node to S, so to the sync. We have discussed synchronous and asynchronous mode when describing the mesh networks. In Wirepass Mesh, both these modes are possible. That means every node can work in synchronous mode and asynchronous mode. Then, and depending on the requirements, also, every node can be configured in one of these two modes that are called TDMA and CSMA. Of course, as discussed, we have different performance in terms of power consumption and latency for these two different modes, and mixed networks are possible. Other functions of Wirepass mesh firmware are the over-the-air firmware update that is triggered by the sync and spread remotely to the whole network. And then the network security based on the AES-128 keys for data encryption and authentication. So this completes my part. And at this point, I would like to hand over to my colleague, Matthias Hauser, to complete the presentation. Thank you.
So thank you, Luca, for the good start of the presentation. So I will continue with the remaining slides. So this slide is about the structure of the radio stack, so to say. First of all, we have three parts. The first part is the Wirepass stack itself. It's a kind of binary that contains all the intelligence of the Wirepass network. That means the automatic connection setup, the periodically update of all connections and the stuff. And the second part is the Wirepass SDK, which is a C code, which is free available on the GitHub. That means this Wirepass Mesh SDK is somehow a kind of driver how to use the Wirepass Mesh stack. And the third part, sorry, I will show my mouse. The third part is the application part. That means that's what the radio module or the Wirepass device should do. Here we have all the options. The two main applications are, as Luca already said before, a kind of single MCU application, that means the device itself does all the job. For example, it's a kind of sensor node where the application calls through the Viapass SDK in the hardware peripherals, calls a kind of sensor, reading its data, and then sending it via the Viapass mesh stack and the hardware peripherals radio, in this case, to the antenna out to the mesh network. The second kind of application, it's a so-called dual MCU application that we will also offer as a radio module. This simply means that all the functions of the Viapass mesh stack are available on the UART via a command interface or via a protocol. And the radio module that is doing this kind of stuff is so-called the TTIS-1 radio module. As I already said, it's a dual MCU radio module based on a Nordic chipset. It offers 39 channels on the 2.4 GHz radio band and offers radio packets with up to 102 bytes per packet. There are many commands on the UART to control the mesh radio stack. They are divided in data commands, configuration commands, and also management commands. You simply have to, understand it like that data commands are simply for data transmission and data reception or data propagation through the network, and configuration and management commands are somehow available for the configuring the mesh setup, so to say, what the mesh should do. On the UART, there is this kind of protocol, it's called CMesh. That means on each request of the host controller, a confirmation is sent back from the radio module to the host controller to tell the host controller that the request was done. On the other side, if a radio packet has been received by the radio module, an indication is sent to the host controller, and in this case, the host controller has to answer with a response to tell the radio module that it has successfully received the data. The nice feature of this kind of operation is that the UART of the radio module can sleep if nothing is to do. That means it's really designed for low power operation. To start with kind of evaluation of the Viapass meshnet, we offer a kind of starter kit. I also have it here in a nice box. I will use it also later on the live demonstration. The starter kit itself, it contains a TTIS-1 USB radio plug or radio stick, which simply acts as a sink. That means it collects the data from the network and pushes it to the computer. I have it here connected to my USB port on the notebook. Then we have a TTIS-1 mini evaluation board, which is simply, it's a TTIS-1 radio module, which is on a base PCB that you can contact all the pins. That means at the end of the day, if you're doing in development for your own application, you can connect here your host controller via UART to the radio module and have access to all the protocol functions that I mentioned before. We will also see it later in the live demonstration what it means. And last but not least, we have three sensor nodes, which are an example of a single MCU application. On this sensor node, we have several sensors. You can see it here, it's really small, but they are there, which communicate with the module, which runs in a kind of standalone mode. And this radio module simply sends the red sensor data to the meshnet. In case the sensor node is close to the sync device, it directly sends to the sync, if it's not close to the sync device, it can connect, for example, to the mini evaluation board, and this relays simply the messages to the sync. On the for the development reason, we have on the PC tool, on the connected on the PC, which is connected to the sync device, we have developed a nice tool, which is so-called the Wirepass Commander, that gives you access to all of the functions of the TTS1 radio module. And I will go on with that. I hope you can see this. So first of all, I show you the hardware. One second. Here, this is the TTS1 USB dongle, which is acting as a sync, connected via a USB cable to my PC here, which is connected to this PC tool. And on the other hand, here is the Symbol MCU application, which is the called sensor node. Probably it's hard to see. There are some sensors, and this is the radio module transmitting the data, which can be sourced by a coin cell. Okay, here's no inside, but in the other nodes, I put it inside. And on the Wirepass Commander, you have, as I already said, you have all the commands available. First of all, the data commands, where you have simply press a button. Here it's a TX request, it's called. Here you can enter your data, whatever you want to send. Hello world in this case, the destination node address, and the destination endpoint. Then there are the management commands for starting stack, stopping stack, for example, setting the radio module to sleep mode, which is also quite nice. And last but not least, the configuration commands. And here I can tell you in a few words, the settings you simply have to, that you have to configure to take a node into operation. There are simply these four settings here. The node role, which can be sync, router or non-router, as has been told by Luca before, the network channel, the network address, and the node address. That means if these four settings are set by you, you can simply press start stack and then you're done. Then the node connects to the network and then you are able to receive and transmit data. What's on the right side on this window here, you have the messages that are placed on the UART. I will shortly stop that to have a short look. Here we have the command, for example, and which is hex code, and above you have an interpretation, which just gives the command a name that you know what's going on. And on the left side, there's a kind of interpretation window that just tells you what's part of the data that has been sent on the UART. For example, here we have an RX response command, which contains, or here RX indication command, which contains received data. And here you have the interpretation of it that simply is sent. There is data which is sent in ASCII format, HIDS, it's one of the sensors, 24%, and all the stuff. PIDS, it's another sensor, which sends the pressure and the current temperature. So I enable this again here. Last but not least, that's the last thing I want to show you before we can start with the questions. There's a relation kit tab, which simply does a graphical display of the received data. That means each received message, it's placed here in a certain data point. Here you have the pressure tab, then the humidity tab for the humidity data of the humidity sensor, and last the temperature tab for the temperature data. I'm gonna change here the time which is shown. So I set it to 1 hour, and there you can see that the room where I'm sitting here, it's steadily getting hotter, so to say. Okay, that was all from my side. Then we can start with questions.
Yes, thanks a lot to both of you for your interesting presentation. As Matthias already mentioned, we would like now to turn our attention to your questions. So feel free to enter them in the chat function in your webinar control panel and we will answer them.
So there's already a first question, which is, does every Wirepass mesh use exactly one sink? No, it does. It must not use only one sink. So that means at the end of the day, you can place as much as sinks as you want to place, but yeah, the trees are somehow separated. That's right. That means the more sinks you place in the network, the more data you can distribute to the sinks, obviously. And that means the more data you can also distribute to the connected server, to the cloud, so to say. Yeah.
So I can take maybe this one. Does a node communicate only on one channel or is frequency hopping supported? Frequency hopping is supported. We have seen also for each link, the channel is chosen in such a way that collision, let's say probability of a packet collision is minimized.
Okay, there's another question. Are the different roles of a node use different versions of the stack? Okay, I understand it like that, that is the node role hard-coded in the stack? It's not. So the stack is highly configurable. Yeah, as you see before here on my window, there are many, many configuration commands, and one of these configuration settings is node role. That means if you want to configure a device as a sync, you can do so. But on the other hand, if you want to use it as a non-router node, you can also do so. So it's up to the application with the same firmware on top. So and I would take the next question. How high is the latency of the system? Yeah, that's a good question. I mean, it's not that easy to answer because first of all, it depends on the mode that are you using. As Luca said before, we have low latency mode, which uses an asynchronous technique, or we have the low power mode, which is using the synchronous mesh technology, and this mainly defines also the latency. That means in synchronous mode, the low latency mode, the message is sent directly. Yeah, that means it receives the receiver, assumed that you only have one hop, it receives 100 milliseconds later latest. Yeah. But if you're using low power mode, the synchronous mesh, then it depends on the update interval of the node. So this can be 2 seconds, 4 seconds, or 8 seconds. It can be defined depending on the network traffic of the node itself. That means in worst case, it takes 8 seconds for one hop in worst case, but only in this synchronous mode. That means if you have an application where you need a fast reaction, you can configure the firmware in this low latency mode.
I see a question here about custom solution or standard solution. And basically, the Tethys one that Matthias has presented during the presentation is, let's say, our standard module with dual implementing a dual MCU solution, so with host-based operation, and but also we're able to provide, let's say, custom solutions, like say if a single MCU wirepass module is a solution is needed, we can also, let's say, take over the firmware, writing the firmware for the wirepass module for the specific application, let's say.
There's a next question, which is really good because I somehow forgot to mention this nice feature. The question is, can I change the role of the sensor node and turn them into a router node? Yeah, yes, you can. There is a nice function in the wirepass network that allows to remotely configure nodes. That means I can use here this wirepass commander, which is connected to the sync device, to remotely set the configuration of the sensor node to routing mode. Yeah. So first answer, the short answer is yes, that's possible. There's another question. What's the maximum distance between two nodes? What's possible? Is it comparable to the Bluetooth mode? So the wirepass firmware uses the 1-bit physical layer of the Bluetooth interface. Yeah, that means concerning or the distance configuration, it's 100% like the Bluetooth, exactly. Yeah. So then I would take a next question. Can wirepass use Bluetooth protocol? Yeah, yes and no. Wirepass node is able to send beacons that are Bluetooth conform. Yeah, that means if you have a Bluetooth device which is scanning, this device can receive these beacons. Yeah, but setting up a Bluetooth connection and having also a performance of a Bluetooth connection with a wirepass node as connection partner, that's not possible.
I can take the next question. What are the main factors influencing the battery lifetime of the nodes? Basically, I mean, the main factors that I would mention are basically how often and, like, say, how much data is sent. Because what drains the batteries is basically sending lots of data. And we have seen that depending on the distance, also the transmit power is adapted. That means if nodes are far away, more power will be used to deliver the packets. And that also means more energy consumption.
So there's another question. How do you compare wirepass with other mesh technologies, for example, Thread or BLE mesh? Yeah, that's not so easy to answer. So first of all, we considered a lot of technology to take it over in our portfolio. The point is, each technology, of course, has its advantages and also disadvantages. We have, for example, in some of our modules, a kind of asynchronous mesh, asynchronous flooding mesh, which is quite nice for transmission of a higher amount of data. And on the other side, we chose wirepass now because its strength is the synchronous routing mesh technology, which means that this kind of mesh, it's really suited for large mesh networks that are have to take care about their energy consumption, where the nodes are battery operated. If we compare to, for example, with BLE mesh, So Bluetooth also of course says that this mesh is really nice because of the low power features or whatever, but at the end of the day it's quite complicated because they have special protocols on the radio interface, which is made much better from Viapath. So that to summarize that what I said is that the Viapath meshnet, it's a good addition to what we already offer here in from Wirth Electronics in the mesh topics.
So a lot of questions are coming in here. I would say maybe one last question. I want to be flexible in my future designs for other protocols like Bluetooth. Do you have one footprint for all?
So the hardware we are using here for the TTS1 radio module, it's a hardware that's used for different kind of modules. Besides this Viapath technology, we have on the ProToys Re radio module, which is the same hardware. It uses Bluetooth Low Energy 5.1, for example. And this third option is the Tyone 1 radio module, which uses 2.4 gigahertz proprietary radio, which also has his advantages, of course. So that means at the end of the day, these three modules are somehow interchangeable from hardware point of view, at least. Yeah.
I can maybe take the last one.
Yeah,
sorry.
For sure. Go ahead.
Does the purchase of a module also include the Viapath license? Yes. So this is included so that no extra license agreement between customer and Viapath is needed. So the answer is yes.
Sounds good.
Thanks.
So thanks, Matthias. Thanks, Luca, for answering the questions. I would say if there are any questions left, we will answer them via email afterwards. But for now, thank you very much for your attention, and we hope you enjoyed the presentation. The next presentation topic is hardware design in HINS for sensors. And this session starts at 2 p.m. and you can still register. So feel free to join here and see you there maybe, and enjoy our digital days. Goodbye.